It's a thing that should never have happened. I mean, it was a fire, it never was a fire.
It's one of these things, I'll never leave your memory. It's a thing I'll never leave your memory.
I don't dwell on it, but I never forget it. You just think what might have been, that's all.
There's some certain things that happen, I've just got to keep the heat.
Forgotten for 75 years, the tragic story of the Glen Cinema disaster has been rediscovered. For the past year, the people of Paisley have been commemorating the 71 children who lost their lives on Hogmanay 1929.
This is one of Scotland's worst cinema disasters that's never been retold. Nobody knows why. There were so many questions, and if you ask anyone in the street in Paisley, do they know anything about the Glen Cinema, everyone will say, yes, I have a relative that was involved, or I know somebody that was in the cinema that day.
Today, what remains of the Glen Cinema lies hidden behind the walls of a furniture shop in Paisley's town centre. Martin Robertson, from a cultural planning company, is leading the project to commemorate the tragedy.
You're actually standing on the original stage of the Glen Cinema. This pillar here would have formed one side of the proscenium arch for the stage, and just to my right would have been an orchestra pit where the musicians would have played while reels were being changed over. Above me is a false ceiling, which covers up all the ornate ceiling that remains. It's very difficult to access, but is in very, very good condition up there. This is what's left of the Glen Cinema building.
Hogmanay, 1929. The women prepare the houses while the men finish their shifts at the factories. With no rest from the mills for Christmas, everybody is looking forward to the holiday.
First of all, being Hogmanay, my mother was at the bank, my father was sleeping because he was night shift, and there was a girl stayed in the next close. She was about 12. And she used to take the younger kids to the matinees.
I mean, like, someone could go every Saturday and every, but I couldn't go every Saturday, you know, we couldn't afford it.
I get up in the morning, get my breakfast, wash and all that. You always have to ask your mother, any dearie George's mother, she said, look in the scullery, down the stairs. Along to Gobray's store, held them over to the girl serving behind the counter, gave me the money, that was me, got my money for the picture.
We looked to see what was on in the cinema and looked to see which was the most gory, the bloodthirsty. So we thought the Glen was going to be the cinema for us that day.
Ye come into the Glen, ye come and with me, the grand entertainment. The church is just one day, the hall is nice and cosy, the show is good they can, 1,000 men will turn the fun down in the Glen.
Nearly 1,000 children queue outside the Glen this afternoon. Brothers and sisters, friends and neighbours, the children of Paisley wait in line. Inside, the chief projectionist loads the first reel of the cowboy flick, Desperado Dude. At 2 p.m., the doors open and the children pile in.
As you went in the door, in that gate, now, in the left-hand side, there was an old lady, and she had a big orange box. That's where the money was put, you in your penny or tuppence, see? I think it was tuppence.
So you either went into the area or up to the gallery. So we went into the area.
It was packed with kids. Yeah, they're always were at any time, but that day in particular, it really was mobbed with children.
There were girls there with kids in their arms. Girls at 10, 11, 12, with children in their arms.
Robert Pope was 7 at the time of the disaster. He returns to the Glen to find where he was sitting that day.
Now, this was a cinema. I was probably sitting here, and there was an opening door, entrance door there, and there's an entrance door there. So you just all blared and shouted and seen your pal, "Hello, Wally," or "Hello, Johnny." And then the only time you knew the picture was going to start was when the attendants came down and started putting out all the lights round about. And then the kids were, "Hey, here the picture's going to start."
The projector is run and the film begins. Heroes battle villains, and the great American planes flood the Glen.
When it came to the goodies and the baddies, we either cheered or booed.
You know, if it's a cowboy film, they're all up jumping, shouting at the Indians and the cowboys and that. These matinees were pandemonium.
After 15 minutes, the first reel comes to an end. The young assistant, James McVeigh, takes the 1,000-foot reel to the rewind room.
In those days of silent cinema, right through until 1950, the stock, the film stock, was of nitrate material. Now, nitrate is a cousin, shall we say, of gun cotton. And we all know how quickly gun cotton can go up. He was probably doing what we call spooling off. In other words, the film had been shown and it was being put back into its can.
The 15-year-old puts the metal can down on top of a battery. Within seconds, the film starts to smoke.
If the film had just come off the projector, whenever it went onto a can which had been heated up by touching the contacts of a battery, the thing just smoked.
Realizing the danger, McVeigh grabs the smoldering film and makes for the nearest exit. Unable to open the door, he drops the can in the hallway and rushes to get help.
The smoke started increasing. He went back and told the chief projectionist. The chief projectionist told him to make his way to the manager's office at the opposite end of the building and tell him what happened.
Hurrying back, the manager forces the door open and kicks the burning reel outside. Inside, the smoke has reached the auditorium.
The picture was the villain had captured, as we see, I think it's Ken Maynard's girlfriend. And he had took her over his hill right down into the big green valley. Then over the top comes a big white horse, and just as that, pew, everything goes black.
Of course, we all kind of jumped up to see what it was.
You could smell the smoke. Oh, there's no doubt about it, you could smell the smoke.
Hazy, dark and white and that.
It was like celluloid burning.
I heard someone shouting, "Fire!"
The air is thick with acrid fumes, and the cry of fire quickly spreads around the cinema.
All the children started getting panicky and they started running, and they were running always.
Kicking, shouting, swearing and everything going on. Mammy, daddy and all that.